On May 26, 2016, police kicked down the door of an LA-based comic book creator and entered his home to find him in his wife fronts, covered in blood, clutching his passport, surrounded by $4,000 in cash. On the floor, dead, his girlfriend, a former Ukrainian tax office prosecutor and supermodel, dead, with her scalp removed and her actual face half peeled off, in a haunting echo of scenes found in his graphic novel Syndrome. When questioned by police, he claimed they had no idea who she was or how she got there, and that he hadn't even noticed that half of her fucking face was hanging off. Drama. Serious drama. This is the real shit. This isn't Tim Doyle threatening to rape your pets. This is murder. The graphic novel killer. Blake Leibel murdered his partner Iana Cassian, recreating scenes from his graphic novel, and when caught in the act of removing her face, he tried the Sirhan defense. I mean, that's like the most mental thing that you can say, right? You're caught with the body of the woman who is the mother of your child and you claim not to know her. That's insane. So naturally that stood out to me. And then, you know, the way that my brain works, it triggered a synaptic chain that takes us through Sirhan, Manchurian candidates, all the way to MK Ultra and CIA mind control shit. Then you start to notice a few people involved, these elite wealthy families, the mob, the Ukrainian tax office prosecutor, Hollywood. And at this point, I must admit that my curiosity is piqued. You can't deny that this story has all the ingredients, so let's do a deep dive on this son of a bitch and try and work out what actually happened here. But before I do that, remember to leave a like on the video, because nothing says justice is served like a YouTube like, right? In 1981, Blake Leibel was born the younger of two brothers to Lorne and Eleanor Leibel. His father, Lorne Leibel, might sound like a shit B-list supervillain, but he was actually a big property tycoon in Toronto who famously sailed for Canada at the 1976 Olympics and was also inducted into the Canadian Motorsports Hall of Fame. Because, you know, these are elitist sports that you can just buy your way into. It's not like football, the people's game that you can play in the dusty back streets of Rio de Janeiro with nothing more than a fucking orange and a dream. You know what I mean? Like, if you can afford a boat, you've already made it. So yeah, he is basically a shit B-list supervillain. And then on top of that, his mother is also independently wealthy. Well, as independently wealthy as generational wealth is. She comes from another one of these elitist Canadian families or whatever. Eleanor Leibel was the heiress to a major manufacturing company around Canada. This real generational wealth stuff. His grandfather as well, for example, left him a large inheritance too, but only on the condition that he get and pass a test. Kind of like the movie Billy Madison, but instead of Adam Sandler going through grade school to inherit his father's company, Grandpa Leibel just wanted Blake to pass a test for HIV/AIDS. So, you know, it's a little bit different. His parents divorced and Blake lived with his mother till his early 20s until he and a bunch of his rich buddies did what all trust fund dickhead wannabes do and moved to LA to make it in Hollywood or whatever. Because like sailing and motorsport, that's a hobby that any talentless fuckwit can just buy themselves into. Along with his brother Cody, the two of them took their $20,000 a month trust fund payments and set off to make a name for themselves. And they were living the high life. In 2008, Blake funded and produced his own movie, Bald, and did some work on Spaceballs, the animated series, a show that I didn't know until this moment existed, and yet, I still don't particularly want to watch it. And the two of them did make a name for themselves also on the poker scene, rubbing shoulders with supermodels and the mafia, throwing around cash, snorting cocaine. You know how it is. I never actually found any evidence that Blake took cocaine, but come on, this is like fucking textbook cocaine territory. His comic book Syndrome was published by mainstream comic industrial complex company Boom Studios. The story revolved around a sadistic doctor named after Blank's mother and a serial killer who he was studying. In the graphic novel, the serial killer murders a man by slitting his throat and hanging him by his ankles till he bleeds out. Leibel describes the novel Syndrome as a story about obsession on a number of levels. The media would eventually go on to draw comparisons between scenes in the book and actual crime scene photos from his LA apartment. And we could do that, you know, like have a look over the actual book and do a YouTube review of it. But I don't know, like, is it tasteless? Would it help us to understand some wider narrative in the murder investigation? You know, like, a real woman is dead. Do we review a murderer's book? Like, what are the moral implications? And what if it's actually good? I don't know. Leave a comment. Convince me one way or the other. In 2011, he married his first wife and they had a child, so now he's kind of settled down away from the party boy movie producer cocaine enthusiast to hard-working comic creator or whatever. But now the money and connections are starting to tighten as he takes on more responsibility and his books are suffering and selling less and less as a result. And then his mother dies. But woohoo! Millions of dollars of inheritance. But then, as quickly as it came, it's gone again. And 1 month before the birth of his second child, he leaves his first wife for a hot Ukrainian supermodel and former tax office prosecutor, Ayana Kassian. And in 2016, she gives birth to what is now Blake's third child. So, you know, he just abandons his family and then starts over with a newer, younger, hotter wife and everything's cool. Except, it's not. Because he's still shagging around and he gets caught out when Blake was arrested on suspicion of sexual assault on the 20th of May 2016, and when the state demanded their $100,000 cash bail, like, whatever, who cares, he's rich, right, he's straight out sipping champagne and eating fucking canapes or whatever. On learning about this though, his girlfriend obviously fucking leaves at it, and her mother, Olga, flies over from Ukraine to help her out because, you know, now she's just given birth a matter of days ago and is now a single immigrant mother with no social safety net. Olga, that's a good strong name. 3 days later, on May the 23rd, Ayana agrees to meet with Blake to talk or whatever and leaves the baby with her mother. And that was the last time that Olga would see her daughter alive. CCTV shows her entering the building as well as a takeaway delivery man a few hours later. When Ayana doesn't return, Olga gets suspicious after being unable to contact her, even making more than 10 calls. Eventually, she turns to the police. Two officers attempted to conduct a search of the apartment. They knocked on the door, but when nobody answered, they just left. Just pretend not to be home when the police knock on your door. It's genius. They just left him a voicemail and fucked off to the donut shop or whatever. Unsatisfied, Olga went to the apartment alone and stood across the street, yelling at Leibel to open the door. She would testify later that she saw him approach the window only to close it and disappear inside. Again, classic. If there's someone shouting at your window, then just close the curtains. That'll stop them. So after 3 days of begging the police to do something, Olga finally convinced them to search his home, and the police were able to get a key for the apartment. But the door was latched and bolted and had been barricaded from the inside with, I don't know, chairs or something. So they kicked the fucking door down and burst right in. And the first thing that they notice is there's little bits of blood around the place. Blake's now hiding in the bedroom, the door again barricaded, and Leibel's quoted as shouting to the police, "She's not here, fuck off." And now we're at that bit where the prologue sizzle at the start of the video is happening in real time in the narrative of the story. He's there in his little pants with his passport and his running away money or whatever, and his girlfriend's there all mutilated and dead. is gruesome and barbaric. The autopsy report said that Cassian's entire scalp was traumatically absent and not found and was not present with the body. Her skull had been stripped down to the surface of the bone. There was no scalp present except for little bits in the back of the neck. Portions of the right side of her face were torn away, including the right ear and part of the posterior face on the right side, all the way down to the jawline. There are a number of bruises and abrasions on the face, primarily on the left side, the left cheek and the left jaw area. A number of bruises and abrasions, including one which turned out to be a human bite mark. She lived for at least 8 hours approximately after receiving the scalp injury and the bruise to the collarbone. So basically, he cut her face off and then let her bleed to death. And when questioned by police, Blake insisted they didn't know who had tortured his girlfriend in his apartment while he was in the room with her for 3 days straight. The only insight they could offer was that the science would prove who did this, and he was right. It did. It was him. He beat her to death and then peeled off her face with a razor blade while mopping up the blood with towels found at the apartment. On the 20th of June 2018, Leibel was convicted of first-degree murder, torture and aggravated mayhem, and was sentenced to life in prison without parole, which is obviously serving right now at a California correctional institution, which I guess means I just doxed the murderer. No, I didn't say what California correctional institution he was at. The mainstream media reported the crime at the time as grisly and possibly the most gruesome murder in the history of West Hollywood, if not Los Angeles, bringing up inevitable comparisons with the Charles Manson family and Sharon Tate and all that jazz. And then we find ourselves back at the MKUltra kind of area once again. So, no, after going over the case, I don't think that there's a mind control or a Hunter Biden conspiracy behind this one. I think the dude's just fucking wacko. Just another trust fund baby with delusions of grandeur and a sense of entitlement that's far greater than his grasp on reality. So fuck that dude. And fuck Boom Studios, I'll never buy anything from you again. So basically I'll carry on exactly the same and nothing will change. Every like on this video increases his prison sentence by 1 year. Hail the chat, hail the mods, hail spam, thanks for watching. I hope you learned something. Like and subscribe and fuck off.